A very good evening, friends. Welcome to today's session. Dr. Anuradha Dhawan here, ophthalmology educator at An Academy. And I welcome you all to today's YouTube session, which is going to be about pupil and its defects. Okay. So, pupil and its defects, again, a very important high-yield topic for your exams. And you have seen lately in your exams, one question based upon pupil has been coming in lot of exams. Okay, so let's begin with our discussion of pupil and its defects. Welcome once again. Now, friends, we know what is a pupil. Pupil is the aperture. Okay, and this aperture, the function of this aperture is to guide the amount of the light which is entering the eye so that we have a clear vision, we have a focused vision. Okay, the change in the size of the pupil is controlled by two muscles of the iris. Okay, so these two muscles are, number one is your sphincter pupillae and second one is your dilator pupillae. Okay, sphincter pupillae brings about the constriction or smaller size of the pupil. Okay, what we call when the pupil becomes, we call it as pupillary constriction. So pupillary constriction is brought about by when there is contraction of sphincter pupillae muscle. Okay, the dilator pupillae, when the dilator pupillae muscle contracts, it brings about the dilatation of the pupil. Okay, so one point I will like to highlight over here is that the dilatation of the pupil is not a passive thing. Okay, it doesn't mean that when the pupil is not constricted, it will be dilated. Dilatation is also an active action due to the contraction of the dilator pupillae muscle. Okay, and the baseline size of the pupil is due to the balance of these two, sphincter pupillae and dilator pupillae. Okay, sphincter pupillae muscle is under the control of parasympathetic system. Okay, sphincter pupillae is under parasympathetic control. Okay, and dilator pupillae is under sympathetic control. Okay, so this is the basic about the how the pupil constriction and dilatation is controlled. Okay, now coming on to the pupillary reflexes. What are the normal pupillary reflexes? Okay, the normal pupillary reflexes, three types of reflexes they can be defined. Number one is your light reflex, that is the reaction of the pupil when the light is thrown on the eye. Second is near reflex. Okay, when the eye is focusing on a near object, again there is a change in the pupil. And the third one is your psychosensory, like when we are agitated, when we are panicky, okay, or fear. So that brings about the psychosensory changes, okay, which again affects the size of the pupil. Now, what happens as a part of light reflex? Okay, we know when we throw light, okay, when we throw light on a normal pupil, the pupil constricts. Okay, the eye onto which the light is thrown, the constriction of the pupil in that eye is known as direct reflex. Okay, that is known as direct reflex. But the other eye also constrict due to the consensual effect. Okay, that we know. So as a normal light reflex, the eye on which the light is thrown constricts as a result of direct light reflex, and the other pupil also constrict in the other eye due to the consensual part of that reflex. Okay, what happens in near reflex? Near reflex, as we know, has got three components. Okay, so that comes into play whenever we are focusing or seeing a near object. So these three components are, number one, your convergence of the eyeballs. Okay, number two, accommodation, the contraction of the ciliary muscle. Number three, the constriction of the pupil. So pupil constrict as a part of near reflex. Okay, and in psychosensory reflex, the pupil dilates when we are in a fear, when we are panicky, the pupil dilates due to sympathetic stimulation. Okay, how these three normal pupillary reflexes, they are manifested. Okay. Now, what are the mechanisms for these reflexes? Fine. What are the, let's go through what are the mechanisms of these reflexes. Now, first of all, let's look at the normal position of the pupil should not be said mid dilated, Dr. Guys. The normal size of the pupil, the normal size of the pupil is usually between, you can say 2 to 4 millimeter can be considered as normal. Normally, it is usually 2 millimeter or so. Okay. It won't be called as mid dilated. Mid dilated means that, you know, if this is the cornea, the mid dilated will be something like 5 millimeter or so. Okay. So the normal size of the pupil is between 2 to 4 millimeter. Right, so now we are going to discuss about the light pathway. Now we are going to discuss about the pathway for the light reflex. Okay, now pathway for the light reflex means that how when the light is shown on the eye, it brings about the constriction of the pupil. It has got two parts. Okay, it has a afferent limb and then it has a efferent limb. Okay, right. The afferent limb is starting at the retina. Okay, it is starting at the retina because the retina has photoreceptors which will sense the light, and then the axons of the ganglion cells through the optic nerve. Okay, through the optic nerve, this sensation is carried. Okay, then we know is the optic chiasma where the crossing of the nasal fibers is happening. Okay, then from the optic chiasma, beyond that is your optic tract, in which there are temporal fibers from the same side and the nasal fibers from the opposite side. Okay, now here, till here, the visual pathway and the light reflex pupillary pathway are same till optic tract. Okay, but from optic tract, the pupillary fibers, they go to midbrain area. Okay, and they go to the pretectal nucleus. They go to pretectal area, to the pretectal nucleus. Okay, from here, from the pretectal area, through the interneurons or the internuncial fibers, now these pupillary fibers, they will go to Edinger-Westphal nucleus. These are your Edinger-Westphal nucleus. Okay, Edinger-Westphal nucleus is a parasympathetic nucleus. It is a parasympathetic nucleus. Now, the thing to be considered over here is that Edinger-Westphal nucleus is getting the fibers from pretectal area of both the sides. Okay. Or you can say the pretectal area of one side is giving fibers to both the sides. Edinger-Westphal nucleus. So this is the basis for your direct and consensual reflex. Okay, because if the light is shining in one eye, these light sensation is being carried by the pupillary fibers till the pretectal area, but the pretectal area is now sending the fibers to both the Edinger-Westphal nuclei, so that these nuclei will now generate the efferent limb in both the eyes. Okay, so now it will be reaction pupillary constriction of both the eyes. What happens from the Edinger-Westphal nucleus? Now the fibers, parasympathetic fibers, are carried by the third nerve. Specifically, the branch which is carrying the fibers for the inferior oblique muscle. These parasympathetic fibers, they synapse in ciliary ganglion, which is again a parasympathetic ganglion. They synapse over here. From the ciliary ganglion, the postganglionic parasympathetic fibers are carried through short ciliary nerves to the sphincter pupillae muscle. Okay, so now this the light is being shown if it into this eye, but this efferent limb is activated in both the eyes. That will bring about the contraction of the sphincter pupillae muscle and constriction of the pupil. Okay, so are we clear about this? So this is your light reflex pathway. Now moving on to the near reflex. Near reflex, just remember one or two points only. The pathway is not very clear to us, but we know that again, whenever there is near object fixation, that is the convergence reflex is there. Here the fibers, they are being carried till the striate and the parastriate area. Okay, so from the optic tract, they go forward to lateral geniculate body, to radiations, striate and the parastriate area. From the parastriate area, they go to a pontine center, and they also go to the nucleus for medial rectus, because medial rectus contraction is required for convergence. From the pontine center, they then go to the Edinger-Westphal nucleus. Okay, and since once they reach the Edinger-Westphal nucleus, then the efferent pathway is nearly the same, and there is an accessory ganglion, there is a ciliary ganglion, and they bring about the constriction of the pupil and convergence of the eyeballs. Okay, so it is not very clear, and we don't really need to spend much time over this also. Just remember, here the fibers are going to parastriate area, then to a pontine center, nucleus for medial rectus, and then to Edinger-Westphal. Okay, so there is a constriction of the pupil in response to the near reflex also. Okay, then a little bit of sympathetic pupillary pathway. Now the sympathetic pathway starts in the hypothalamus. Okay, sympathetic fibers, they start in the hypothalamus. Through the brainstem, they go to the sympathetic center in the spinal cord, which is known as ciliospinal center of Budge. Okay, from here the fibers, they through the sympathetic change, they synapse in superior cervical ganglion, which is a sympathetic ganglion. From here the postganglionic fibers, they are carried, and through the long ciliary nerves, they supply the dilator pupillary muscle. Okay, they supply the dilator pupillary muscle, which brings about the dilatation. Okay, so these are the main important points about the three pathways: the light reflex, the near reflex, and the sympathetic pathway. Okay, now after the normal anatomy and the normal physiology, now let's discuss about the pupillary defects. Okay, so first of all, we'll be discussing about the afferent pupillary defects. Afferent means when the afferent limb of the light reflex, there is some problem in the afferent limb. What can be the problem in the afferent limb? Okay, afferent limb is your retina, your optic nerve. Okay, so if there is any lesion of the optic nerve or there is a disease of the retina, it will bring about the afferent pupillary defect. Now the afferent pupillary defect can be absolute pupillary defect. Absolute means that you are shining the light onto the eye and the pupil does not constrict at all. Okay, pupil does not constrict at all. Okay, so what will happen in absolute pupillary defect? The direct reflex is absent, and in the affected eye, direct reflex is absent in the affected eye, and consensual is absent in the other eye. Okay, because consensual in the other eye is due to the afferent of the affected eye. Okay, so this is what will happen. So this will happen in the case of lesion of optic nerve or retina, which has led to complete blindness. So that will lead to absolute pupillary defect or APD. Okay, then there is relative afferent pupillary defect, which is also known as RAPD, relative afferent pupillary defect. Yes, that can be the feature. So relative afferent pupillary defect. So what happens in relative afferent pupillary defect? Here, if you see, there is an incomplete lesion of the optic nerve, or there is a severe retinal disease, but there is not the complete blindness. Okay. So when you shine the light, there will be some pupillary constriction, but this pupillary constriction is not normal. Okay. And how we will judge that this is not normal? We'll just see. This type of the pupil is known as Marcus Gunn pupil. The pupil which is having relative afferent pupillary defect is known as Marcus Gunn pupil. So Marcus Gunn pupil is diagnosed by a test which is known as swinging flashlight test. Swinging flashlight test. Okay. So just listen to this carefully. What happens in relative afferent pupillary defect? Now, when we say relative, please understand it is incomplete. Okay. It is not that you will shine the light, the pupil will not react. It is reacting, but the reaction is subnormal. Okay. So we make use of this. So this is your right eye, this is your left eye. Here, left eye is abnormal. Okay. There is optic nerve or retinal abnormality in the left eye. Now, what will happen? Right eye is normal. Now, when we are bringing the torch in front of the normal eye, okay, then this eye will constrict due to the direct reflex and the left eye will also constrict due to the consensual reflex. Okay, now you bring the light from the right eye to the left eye. Okay, normally what should happen? If left eye was normal, again the left eye should constrict and the other eye also should constrict as a consensual. But here what is happening, when we are bringing the light in front of the abnormal eye, the pupil paradoxically dilates. Rather than showing a constriction to the light, it paradoxically dilates. And that is what is known as Marcus Gunn pupil. Why it is dilating? Because the consensual which was there in this eye, which has brought about the constriction. Okay. When the light moves away from the normal eye, that consensual reflex goes away and the direct reflex of this abnormal eye is weaker. Okay. Due to the weak reflex, this eye constriction is not now maintained. It appears to be dilating because the consensual of the other eye is waning off and the direct reflex of this eye is weaker. So it appears when we bring the torch from the normal side to the abnormal side, it appears that it is dilating. Okay. And it is dilating because it has weak light reflex as compared to the normal eye. When you will bring it again to the normal eye, this will constrict. So this is your swinging flashlight. When you show the light to the normal eye, the abnormal eye constricts. When you bring it to the abnormal eye, it dilates. So this helps us in testing swinging flashlight test. Okay. Then I have sometimes a question from the students, then that why the swinging flashlight test is not used for absolute afferent pupillary defect. There is no need. Okay. Because in afferent pupillary defect, we know there is complete absence of the light reflex due to the afferent pathway complete abnormality. Okay. So here it is incomplete. That is why we have to kind of diagnose it by doing this swinging flashlight. Fine. Right. Now we move on to the what will happen if there is a defect in the efferent limb. Efferent limb is your motor limb. Okay. So the defect can be at the level of the parasympathetic nucleus. Okay. That is in the midbrain. It can be due to the palsy of the third nerve. It can be due to the effect of the parasympatholytic drugs. Okay. Pharmacological. Or it can be due to the trauma. Okay. If there is trauma to the iris sphincter muscle, the muscle is affected. The muscle will not constrict. Okay. So what will happen in this? It is a motor defect. So there will be absence of both direct as well as consensual because it is the motor component which is now defective. So whether it is a direct or consensual, that will be absent in case of efferent pupillary defect. Okay. Okay. Now we go ahead and we talk about certain conditions, peculiar pupil abnormalities which we come across. One is your AR pupil, that is Argel-Robertson pupil. Okay. So what is Argel-Robertson pupil? Now what we see in these cases, we see the pupils are meiotic, they are smaller and they are irregular. Okay. So small irregular pupils. When you bring a near reflex or a near target to these eyes, the reaction is present. Okay. That is the pupils, they will constrict to the near reflex. Okay. But when we show the torchlight, the pupils, they do not react. Okay. Showing the torchlight, pupil Do not react in both the eyes. Bringing a near target, pupils, they react briskly to accommodation. So, accommodation reflex is present. Accommodation reflex present. So, this is the mnemonic to help you remember that what happens in Argyll-Robertson pupil. The reaction to the light is absent, but reaction to accommodation is present. Okay. This is known as light near dissociation. Otherwise, normally it should react to near also, it should react to light also. But here there is light near dissociation. Okay. The reason is the lesion in the midbrain. Okay. The most common cause associated is your neurosyphilis. Neurosyphilis is the most commonly associated cause. Okay. And once again, revising how we will diagnose, the accommodation reflex is present and light reflex is absent. And the pupils, they are smaller and irregular in shape, right? Then another type of your pupillary abnormality is Aedes tonic pupil. Now, what happens in Aedes tonic pupil? Tonic means the muscle has become sort of fixed, okay? It is like, it does not constrict properly and it does not dilate also properly, okay? So, Aedes tonic pupil is usually unilateral. In contrast to the Argyll-Robertson pupil, which is bilateral, this is usually unilateral. Here, the pupil is dilated, okay? Because it's not able to constrict. So, it stays in mid-dilated position, okay? Light reaction is absent. It does not constrict to light. Near reaction is also very slow. Okay, again in contrast there the near reaction is normal. Here it is very slow but present. Okay, now here the lesion is in post-ganglionic part. Okay, there is any problem related to the post-ganglionic fibers. Okay, now due to the post-ganglionic lesion, the muscle becomes hypersensitive. There is what is known as denervation hypersensitivity, that when we are giving weak concentrations of the pilocarpine also 0.125%, normally we are using 1% clinically, but here when we are giving such a weak concentration of pilocarpine, Aedes pupil will react due to denervation hypersensitivity. Okay, so that is used to diagnose Aedes, that if the pupil which is dilated constricts with the use of 0.125% pilocarpine, that indicates the constrict, that it is a Aedes tonic pupil. In swinging flashlight, I think I need to show you once again. Let me just finish the Aedes tonic pupil. Now, another feature to be remembered in Aedes tonic pupil is when this is associated with orthostatic hypotension and absence of deep tendon reflexes, that is the absence or weakness of knee jerk or ankle jerk, then this is known as Holmes Aedes syndrome. Okay, so friends, let me just go back to the swinging flashlight test once. So in swinging flashlight, when the torch is on the abnormal pupil, both pupils will dilate. Okay, when the torch light or the light is shining on abnormal pupil, then both pupils will dilate. Okay, so is it clear? And when it is on normal eye, then both pupils will constrict. Okay, just once more. See, what is happening, the key to understand the Marcus Gunn pupil is, you have to understand in this, that in this one eye is normal, okay? So, the direct reflex of that eye, the normal eye, direct reflex of that eye will be full, okay? It will be complete. Due to this, the consensual effect in the abnormal eye will also be complete. Okay, so when I am shining the torch light on the normal eye, it is constricting, and due to the direct reflex of this eye, the pupil of the abnormal eye is also constricting, okay, and it is constricting fully, okay. Now when I am bringing the torch to the abnormal eye, so this eye, the pupillary reflex, you can say, is incomplete. So when I'm coming from normal to abnormal, the initially it was well constricted, but now since its own reflex is incomplete, it dilates. From the previous constriction, it dilates because its own direct reflex is weak. Its own direct reflex is weak, the other eye will also dilate. Okay, so that appears that when you are bringing the light from the normal to abnormal eye, instead of maintaining its constriction, what should happen normally? What should happen if there is no RAPD? Okay, so if there is no RAPD, normal eye, both eyes are normal, okay, right and left. Okay, you shine the torch to this light, both eyes constrict. You bring the light to this eye, the constriction should be maintained because both eyes are acting normally. Okay, that should happen. You bring it back to the right eye, it should stay constricted. You take back to the other eye, it should stay constricted. So if both eyes are normal and you keep swinging the light between the two, the constriction will be maintained. But here, since one eye is abnormal, now if the left eye is abnormal, so when I'm shining the light to the normal eye, the constriction is there. But when we are bringing the light to the abnormal eye, its reaction is much weaker than the normal constriction. So it dilates. Okay. It dilates and the other also dilates due to its consensual effect. So when we are bringing it in front of the abnormal eye, both pupils dilate. When we bring it in front of the normal eye, both pupils constrict. Okay. So I hope it is better now. Better understood. Imagine, compare it with the normal. In normal, what should happen? Both the eyes, they should keep maintaining their constriction. Here, when the light is in front of the abnormal eye, it dilates. Both eyes will dilate. And when it is in front of the normal eye, both eyes will constrict. Okay? Right? Okay. Yes, absolutely, right. Okay, friends, now we move on to the Horner syndrome, which is the abnormality of the sympathetic system. Okay, now concentrate on the Horner syndrome. Horner syndrome is there is a lesion in the sympathetic system. Now, in the eye, the sympathetic system is supplying, as we just saw, the dilator pupillae muscle. And it also supplies the Müller muscle of the lids. Okay. Now, if there is a lesion in the sympathetic system, that what happens in Horner syndrome, what are the presentations in the eye? There is mild ptosis due to the weakness of the Müller muscle. There is also apparent enophthalmos, again due to the involvement of the Müller muscle. The eye appears to be retracted inwards. Okay, then due to the weakness of the dilator pupillary muscle, the pupil becomes smaller in size, miosis, because now there is unopposed action of the constrictor muscle. Okay, the reaction to the light and near will remain normal in Horner. Again, a very good point to remember. Nothing will happen to the light reflex or the near reflex because parasympathetic system is normal. It's your sympathetic system which is abnormal in Horner. So what will happen, that when the patient goes to dark, the pupil is not able to dilate and there is what is known as dilatation lag. Okay, the pupil will not be able to dilate in dark. There is dilation lag. Okay, and it will bring about difference in the size of the pupils, two pupils, which is known as anisocoria, and this anisocoria will increase in dark because the Horner pupil is not able to dilate in the dark. Okay, then the patient may present with iris heterochromia, especially if the disease is congenital or in the long standing cases of the Horner. There can be change in the color of the iris also. okay, and the Horner pupil is lighter in color, okay. If the lesion is above the ganglion, that is the preganglionic lesions will bring about the decreased sweating also, ipsilateral anhidrosis, what is known as, okay. So these are the features of Horner syndrome, okay. Right, now we come to another important topic which many a times again we get confused that what is this. Let's try to simplify it and let's try to understand it. That is your anisocoria. Okay, so what is anisocoria? Anisocoria means when there is difference in the size of the pupil of the two eyes. Okay, so normally the two eyes, they should have similar sized pupils. Okay, if the difference in the size of the two pupils is 0.4 millimeter or more, that is known as anisocoria. Okay, anisocoria can be physiological also, that is a normal variation. Okay, or it can be pathological. Okay, so physiological, when we will say it physiological, when this difference in the size is same in dark and light, okay, that you check the pupil size in the dark conditions, you check the pupil size in light conditions, if that difference stays the same, it means it is a physiological anisocoria, a normal variation. Okay, but if it increases in dark or in light, there is some pathology. Okay, now let us understand. If it increases in dark, so I just told you only, if it increases in dark, why, when the difference in the size of the two pupils will increase in the dark, when abnormal one is not able to dilate in the dark, what should happen in the dark? If this is the two pupils, okay, what should, if you go in the dark, what should happen? Both they should dilate. Okay, but if there is a sympathetic abnormality like in Horner, that pupil will not dilate, the other one will dilate. So normal one dilates, the abnormal one does not dilate, it remains smaller only, and the difference in the size of the two, that is anisocoria, increases. So when anisocoria increases in dark, it means smaller pupil is abnormal. The pupil which is not able to dilate is the one which is abnormal. Okay, and it indicates sympathetic abnormality, mostly like in Horner syndrome. Okay, when the anisocoria will increase in light, what should happen in light? Again, if this is one pupil, other pupil, supposedly right eye, left eye, if both are normal and the patient goes into bright light, this should constrict, this should also constrict. But what happens if the left eye is abnormal? The right one constrict and the left one does not constrict. So the difference in the size of the two increases. So if the anisocoria increases in light, the larger pupil is abnormal because it is not able to constrict. Larger pupil is abnormal because it is not able to constrict, so difference in the size will increase. So that will indicate when there are multiple reasons for that. When the anisocoria increases in light, there can be problem in the third nerve. It can be third nerve palsy. Okay, there can be the pharmacological dilatation, that the pupil is dilated pharmacologically, so it is not able to react. Okay, it can be due to trauma to the iris. Okay, the muscle itself is damaged, it's not able to react. So these can be your main causes for when the pupil anisocoria increases in light. Similarly, AD's tonic pupil, the tonic pupil is not able to dilate in the constrict in the light. So anisocoria will increase. So these are the reasons when the anisocoria will increase in light conditions. Okay, so just the last discussion, that how we will diagnose or how we will evaluate a patient with anisocoria. So as I told you, we will check whether the anisocoria is increasing in dark or it is increasing in light. If it is increasing in dark, ओके सो इट मीन्स द लार्जर प्यूपिल इज एबनॉर्मल. लार्जर प्यूपिल इज द वन विच इज एबनॉर्मल. ओके सो वट वी विल डू, वी विल गिव, वी आर सस्पेक्टिंग सिंपथेटिक प्रॉब्लम, वी विल पुट 0.5%, I have mentioned it wrong here. Here the smaller pupil will be abnormal, the one which is not able to dilate. In dark, the smaller pupil is abnormal. So here we will put 0.5% apraclonidine. If the pupil dilates, that indicates Horner syndrome. Okay, that indicates Horner syndrome. So this is how we will clinically evaluate that what is the reason for that. Now, if the anisocoria is increasing in light, so as I told you, then the multiple reasons are there. Okay, so we can check for the extraocular muscle move, action. Okay, we will look whether there is any ptosis or not. If there is weakness of the extraocular muscles, ptosis, then third nerve palsy can be the reason. If these are normal, then we will use point that is a weak pilocarpine concentration. If the pupil constricts now, that indicates ADs due to denervation hypersensitivity. Okay. If the pupil still does not constrict, we will put higher concentration of pilocarpine. Okay, if even with the higher concentration of the pilocarpine, the pupil is not constricting, that indicates that there is a pharmacological dilatation. Okay, and to look for any iris trauma, we will do the slit lamp examination. So that will tell us if there are sphincter tears, that will help us to rule out the trauma. So this way we can rule out the different causes of anisocoria increasing in the light. Okay, when it increasing in the light means the pupil is not able to constrict properly. This way we can pinpoint that what is the reason for this. Okay, right. So with this we finish the discussion and let's have few MCQs to revise. You can tell me your answers in the chat box. ADs, beta, ADs, nothing much complicated is there. Okay. See, tonic pupil. Tonic means it has become relatively fixed. Okay. So, it is not able to constrict. Okay. So, in response to the light, the ADs pupil is not able to constrict. So, that is why it appears bigger in size. Okay. It is unilateral. In comparison to the normal pupil, it will be bigger. It will be mid-dilated. Okay. You bring about the light torch in front of the pupil, the light reaction will be absent because pupil is tonic. Tonic means fixed. It is not able to constrict. You bring the near target, the near reflex is present, but again, very, very slow. And if you even take him to the dark, the dilatation is also very slow. Okay, so pupil has become tonic. It is neither constricting nor it is dilating fast. So that is what is happening in ADs tonic pupil. And the problem is in the postganglionic lesion. Because of that, we make use of denervation hypersensitivity. Whenever there is postganglionic lesion, the muscle, when you use even the weaker concentration of the receptor for that muscle, due to denervation hypersensitivity, that muscle will react. So that is why when we are using very weak concentration of pilocarpine, the pupil will constrict. Otherwise, it is not constricting. It is tonic in nature. But with the weaker concentration, it constricts. Whereas a normal pupil will not constrict with this concentration of pilocarpine, which is very, very weak. Okay. So that is your ADs tonic pupil, right? Yes, definitely, Dr. Gaius, definitely. So let's do few MCQs so that we can just apply our knowledge, whatever we have learned. Okay. So please write the answers. Yes, it can cause. Mostly it is of viral, post-viral can cause Aedes pupil. Yes. Okay, so pupillary reflex is retained in the lesion of optic nerve, lateral geniculate body, ciliary ganglion, oculomotor nerve. You can write down your answers in the chat. Yes, pupillary reflex retained means that it will be normal in the lesions of lateral geniculate body. So beyond optic tract, because beyond optic tract, the pupillary fibers are now not in the same path as the visual pathway. Okay, so lateral geniculate body, optic radiations, occipital cortex, the pupillary reflex will remain normal. Yes, all of you, very good. Okay, moving on to the next question. Swinging flashlight test is done to check for Aedes pupil, Marcus Gunn pupil, Horner's pupil, absolute afferent pupillary defect. Swinging flashlight test is done for. Yes, very good. Again, the choice B. And I think now you are clear. There is no need to do swinging flashlight for absolute, because in absolute, the pupillary reaction is absolutely absent. The direct reflex is completely absent in the involved eye. Okay. Right. Anisocoria, which increases in the dark, could be due to. Anisocoria, which increases in the dark, could be due to Aedes tonic pupil, Horner syndrome, pharmacological, third nerve palsy. So again, once again, there is a hat trick of the choice B. Yes, you guys are right. Horner syndrome. Anisocoria, which increases in the dark, means abnormal pupil is not able to dilate. Okay, because the normal pupil will dilate, this pupil is not able to dilate, and the anisocoria increases. It means the problem is in the sympathetic system. So Horner syndrome. Now, in unilateral afferent pupillary defect, when light is moved from the normal to the affected eye, when the light is moved from the normal to the affected eye, there is dilatation in affected and constriction in normal, dilation in normal, constriction in affected, dilation in both the pupils, constriction in both the pupils. So what is your answer now here? From the normal, when you will take the light to abnormal. Yes, very good. So because abnormal, the reaction is not normal, so the other eye will also dilate due to the weak consensual. No, this is not, A is not the answer, because this normal eye will not constrict. Now it is the consensual. Now when we are talking about afferent, this normal eye is reacting due to the consensual of the abnormal eye. So here the consensual will be dilatation. It will constrict when the light is shining in the normal eye. Okay? Yes. Okay. Last question of the session. All of the following are features of Horner syndrome caused by Pancoast tumor except. So multiple causes of Horner syndrome are there. Pancoast lesion are the preganglionic lesions. So all of the following are the features of Horner syndrome caused by Pancoast tumor except. So here the right answer, guys, is no, excessive sweating. They are asking except. Except means that is not the feature. So meiosis is a feature. We know ptosis is a feature. Ciliospinal reflex is again a normal reflex. What is ciliospinal reflex? If we pinch your neck from behind, the nape of the neck, if we pinch the nape of the neck, the pupil will dilate because of the sympathetic stimulation. Okay, so that is known as ciliospinal reflex. So since in Horner the sympathetic is abnormal, so there is loss of ciliospinal reflex. Okay, and in Horner, if the lesion is preganglionic, there is anhidrosis. There is absence of sweating, not excessive sweating. There is absence of sweating. So the right answer to this question is question D. Right? Okay. Okay, friends. So that brings us to the end of this session, and I hope you had good learning. And wish you all the very best. Keep learning and hope to see you soon. Okay, friends? Yeah, exactly. Right? Okay, friends.